life can't be monotonous, right? I think sometimes when you see different opportunities and how you react and how you come out of it, it tells you who you are. And I'm glad that it happened. Welcome to Spotlight. In conversation today, Mr. Tilak Pirigama, CEO of SDB Bank. Welcome, Mr. Pirigama.
Thank you. Thank you for having me here.
Right. Some call you the godfather of digital banking in Sri Lanka. Now, it's a pretty big title. How do you see your role in bringing digital banking to the masses?
Yeah, well, I think thank you very much for that compliment. And probably I was privileged to do some work when I got back to Sri Lanka after working overseas for quite a long time. So maybe it was right time at the right place. I was able to do some work on the digital banking front, particularly when I was at NTB with Freemi, then also now with UPay. So I think UPay is a very interesting proposition. Being a bank, SDB Bank, being a bank focused on more rural folks, and got access to about 3-4 million customers directly and directly. I think we are placed very well to do something for the rural and masses in Sri Lanka, which I consider as a opportunity, which definitely we want to sort of work on. So UPay is actually a wallet, and you can connect your bank accounts, debit cards, credit cards, and carry out your transactions. It's as simple as that. So signing up is very simple, because for an app to be successful, you have to make it simple, and it has to be sort of so simple that everyone can, you know, use it without much of a learning and a teaching. So I think UPay has been designed with that in mind, has been implemented with that in mind. So that way I think we see success. That we have been around with UPay for about a year, and we have seen, I think, quite a lot of traction, and I think quite a usage as well. I mean, obviously the COVID-19 gave us a opportunity. I mean, we saw a spike of on account of COVID-19, but it also has got slightly now normalized because people have got back to their normal life. Yeah, I think talking about masses, our intention is offer this service. I mean, it's a free service for everyone who has a smartphone, and you can sign up. I mean, you can do simple things like bill payments. Like, everyone has to pay a mobile bill, maybe a light bill, water bill, and so on. So all those can be done. Then also we offer services like you can pay your insurance premiums, lease payments, and the government taxes and so on, like council taxes and so on. And these are essential for everyone. So now we also provide services to purchase at merchant points through Lanka QR, as well as we also have a debit card and credit card acquiring services. I mean, all that put together, I'm sure this will be a quite interesting proposition for a lot of rural folks. Mm-hmm. And mind you, Sri Lanka has still 80% of population in rural areas, mm-hmm. As per official stats. So there are a lot of opportunities, and it's very interesting times also. And in terms of Sri Lanka's infrastructure, we are ready, because we got a great mobile infrastructure that's world class. And we have ended up with something like 28 million mobile phones. That definitely give us, I think, some kind of edge in terms of rolling out these services.
Thank you. Statistics show that approximately 650 billion rupees lies outside the banking system. What, if anything, can be done to bring at least a fraction of this money that's outside the system into the banking system?
Yeah. Well, that is one of our dreams. I want to convert that to actually digital, right? I mean, not me alone. I think there are a lot of industry players must play their role, including the institutions like Central Bank of Sri Lanka, Government of Sri Lanka, and so on. But in fact, in first quarter of this year, it has gone to 800 billion. But generally, it has been static around 650 billion. You're correct to say that. But I think being there static is a good sign. It's not going up, right? But now digital payments can bring that down, because we see, if you look at stats again, we see internet banking, mobile banking, payment services like UPay and being heavily utilized, and the growth of these services every quarter about 30, 40, sometimes 50%. In some quarters, it has even touched 100%. This is in terms of value and volume, which is good news. And so the more and more we use these services, I mean, ultimately need of cash will diminish, right? So with that, I'm sure this 650, even if you get 10% out of it, 20% out of it, it will be available in the banks for credit purposes, as well as, you know, you earn interest. So there's benefit on both sides. You earn something, at the same time you help the country by way of saving to provide better credit. So, and that also can bring down the cost of credit. So it will be a huge opportunity for Sri Lanka from a development perspective. Mm-hmm. And you have more credit now available at a cheaper cost. So a lot of entrepreneurs can make this opportunity. So I think we must, as a nation, must work on that to bring down cash usage. I'm sure there are a lot of initiatives. In fact, Central Bank of Sri Lanka has declared 2020 as the year of digital transactions. I mean, it got a bit distracted because of COVID, but I think there is a launch event going to happen soon. I think that initiative, and also I can see the government of Sri Lanka, particularly the president, is very keen on technology, right? I know all that put together, I'm sure there will be a boost quickly. And I think we must identify this as an area of focus. Mm-hmm. And if we work on that, I think I'm sure we can bring that down.
Right. You are the author of two very famous payment platforms in Sri Lanka, Freemi, and now UPay with SDB Bank. How do you see the growth of digital payment platforms, wallets, and so on in Sri Lanka? Are we moving fast enough?
Well, it's a very interesting question. I think, yes, I think we are moving. I don't say we are moving fast enough because to some extent, as I said earlier, we got 28 million phones. I mean, not all are smartphones. At least I would say good half of them are smartphones. Because we need smartphones to offer these services. You can't do it on other phones. And also smartphones are not that expensive either now. So, but if we push ahead this together, not only UPI, I mean, there are other app providers, there are other institutions doing similar things. I'm sure we can popularize this. And I see this can be something like what happened to the mobile phones in Sri Lanka. Not sure if you can remember when it came to Sri Lanka back in the 1970s. It was like rich man's toy kind of thing.
Yes.
But now it is so everyone's thing, like everyone has even more than a phone now. Mm. in most cases.
Mm.
So I think we were able to popularize mobile phones to that level. So similarly, the apps also can be made sort of, you know, can have similar growth. But however, apps are slightly more complicated or complex than a mobile phone, but still it's a technology, right? If you know how to use technology. But I think if we design apps with user in mind, when I say user, any average user who maybe not be even educated or not exposed to technology, if you design the app in mind that, you know, we want to sort of them to use it, then I think your designs, your sort of journeys you have on the app and all that, you know, for them. So that I think can help them drive this, right? I mean, that's one aspect. At the same time, you have to create the need. And in Sri Lanka, cash is just available. We got almost about, I think, close to 8,000 ATMs. So you're basically making, that is also available. That again, I think something we should watch when we grow that, you're indirectly saying you can take your cash out, right? Mm-hmm. But if you also, I think, not do that so much, probably I think that also will, I think, people will drive people using apps. I think, I'm sure you have heard this success story in Kenya with M-Pesa. That's again a mobile app. Which they started using. It was a bit of an accident as well. In Kenya, being such a large country with not so many bank branches around, people had to use the alternative methods to transfer money from the cities to villages. So they used the mobile network. It's more like they transferred airtime. So that was cashable in a village. So that became a great success story in Kenya. But I think the point I want to make here is like that was a need. Right, had a impact on usage of apps. But in Sri Lanka, our infrastructure is fairly good. Mm-hmm. And so as a result, sometimes you don't necessarily, it might not work the same way it worked in Kenya, but I think we also had to create the need. Mm-hmm. So how do you create the need? I think most payments in Sri Lanka, we should make them digital. Start with the government payments, like we know that now customs has got into digital payments. Mm-hmm. And most banks are doing digital payments. In fact, usage of checks in terms of value and volume is going down every quarter 10%, which is a very good story.
Mm-hmm.
That means bulk payments like RTGS, slips and SEPs taking over that space. But still, the consumer side is not really taking off as much as we like to.
Mm-hmm.
But of course, debit cards, credit cards, again, they're a form of digital.
Mm-hmm.
They're taking off.
Mm-hmm.
But apps is, I would say, at very early stage. But the good news about most technologies is that, you know, when it takes off exponentially. So we are more like coming to that,
right,
with awareness, and now central bank is going to run a campaign soon, all that put together, I'm sure, you know, we see this, I think, going, I think, further, I think even beyond exponentially.
Right. Language has always been an issue.
Yeah.
Especially in Sri Lanka. Do you see mobile phones coming pre-packaged with Sinhala?
Yeah. Well, I think that will be helpful, but may not be really useful. But I go back to, again, design principles of apps. Like, you know, you can put icons. I mean, that tells the story what you have to do, right? Now, look at road signs. It's not a language thing.
Sure.
Like, you understand when you look at road signs. I think the app designer should take care of that part. It's not more of a language barrier. It was more of, I think, how you create your design, communicate that message. It's like marketing.
Right.
Okay. And then I think people will get it, and then language will not be such a big barrier. But having said that, I mean, every app has its part of, you know, requirement for language, like terms and conditions to what to do, how to do, and things like that. So I think there it'll help. In fact, UP has all three languages. We got English, Sinhalese, and Tamil. So we have catered that need pretty well.
Mm-hmm.
And also we use language which is very common, not very complex Sinhalese words and things like that. I think it's more of, I think, day-to-day words we use. I think that will help definitely drive.
Mm-hmm.
But I think more than the language, I think your app design should take care of the matter rather than, I think, creating limitation on the language.
COVID-19 brought on a lot of challenges. The economy was hit quite badly. However, it's given rise to entrepreneurship and forced companies to go digital. Do you think that this is the new normal, or are we entering a new era?
Well, I think it depends on how you want to define your new normal, right? I mean, I see, yes, I think when we were locked down, right, when we were working from home, I mean, there were a lot of activities we saw on internet-based payments, digital-based payments, and so on, because we could not reach out to a bank and an ATM, right? But it has come down a little bit now. So I think new normal is not the spike we saw in March and April, right? And also, when you talk about technology for businesses, it's not only the payments, right? In Sri Lanka, the best infrastructure currently available on in form of technologies, the payments. And the banking infrastructure. But for an example, for you to do business, you need other components as well, right? Now, what I saw was, from my own personal experiences, I think the payments space did a great job.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, particularly the banks and central bank and all the other players got together and did a, I think, fantastic job. Like, there was no complaint about not being able to access to your finances. Like, I think that is a great story. But every other business had their own piece of technologies they use, right? And so I'm not sure whether they got to that in other industries, but from a banking perspective, I saw clearly the payments space did very well, and the investment we had made in the past helped us help the customers too. Then we got into other areas, like, now, for an example, I run a branch network of 94 across Sri Lanka. Those days, it was a bit, I think, sort of, you're used to it. Like, you ask your regional management and so on to come to Colombo for a meeting every month or every other week kind of thing. So I think during that time, we got into Zoom and team. I think that helped us tremendously to transform even ourselves. Now everyone is always on Zoom. Like, Zoom or Teams have become a like day-to-day thing now. So that helped us transform from not only for payments, like even our day-to-day life. So in fact, our HR team is running some training now on those digital platforms, right? So while we were doing that, we also understood, sort of we learned that some of the infrastructure even within the bank was not good enough. So recently we, bought quite a number of mobile phones and we gave it to our staff. Like,
yeah.
We want them to be digital as well. I think you have to enable these pieces in different businesses. By doing that, I'm sure, I think it's not only the payments and the banking can go digital, other industries can go digital and help themselves. So I hope the COVID-19 has given them also that sort of, I would say, input or the sort of reason to think about it. I'm sure they'll make the opportunity.
You're an accidental banker, and yet you've never looked back. Any regrets?
Oh, no, definitely not. definitely not. And I think I'm glad that it happened, because see, life can't be monotonous, right? I think sometimes when you see different opportunities and how you react and how you come out of it, I think it tells you who you are, and then it helps you to sort of understand, you know, what kind of person is you in terms of taking challenges. So to that extent, I have no regrets. In fact, I'm glad. I feel I'm privileged to be in this situation as well. Had I been an engineer, I would have been I would be someone else. But I would be different, right? And also, I think banking is an essential service in my opinion. It's a national service, right? We take care of all citizens of the country as industry. To that extent, I would say I'm privileged and happy that I'm in a bank. And also, it's a privilege again to lead a bank. I think that I have no regrets. In fact, I'm thankful to the forces that helped me to be a banker.
We're going through tremendous changes as a country. Appointment of a new cabinet and so on. How do you see Sri Lanka in the next year? And what, if any, policy changes should be affected for us to realize our potential as a nation?
I think to answer the first part of the question, I'm very optimistic. Now, if you look at within a few months, our Sri Lanka exports have got back to where it was a year ago. I think we have hit $1 billion mark, according to the press. So I think that's very good news. And also, I think we have to sort of get back to in other areas, like even import controls, I think we should go away. And I think that to me, why I'm optimistic, you see, I always think about what I can do best to make this situation a better situation. I mean, as a CEO of a bank, but I'm sure everyone else thinks the same way. So every CEO of this country, I'm sure thinking that we can't let go, right? I think that will drive us, I think, doing things better or different things to get back to normal, I think, faster. So I think to that extent, I'm very optimistic about it. Then on the policy side and so on, I think, we know Sri Lanka has quite a bit of debt that has impact on everything, overall economy as well. I think maybe Sri Lanka need a different approach in terms of developing the country and also I think approaching the existing problems. I mean, I would say some areas like FDIs, foreign direct investment and so on can help the country, particularly maybe on BOT basis. Like, you know, we don't have to be in debt to develop the country, and you can invite interested parties to come and set up things here, run for a while, then I think transfer. I think I'm sure you spoken to Mahathir Mohan sometime back.
Yes.
In 60s, that's what exactly Mahathir did. He invited interested foreign investors to come and set up their own network, for example. I think he did, I think, some 6,000, 8,000 kilometers without spending a cent from the government funding. And after, I think, 15 years or so, they transferred back to the government. I think it's very successful.
Yeah.
And so similarly, I think Sri Lanka should get into something like that. It can be sometimes sensitive. It's like someone else is running the infrastructure. But I think we are in a connected global world. I don't think we should be picky or choosy about it. That will help the country.
Mm-hmm.
And on the policy side, I think education should be looked at, I think, critically. Because our education system has not really done very well, particularly the university education and so on. I think we have a lot of private universities now doing a better job than I think some of the state universities. I think education and things like that should be looked at. And also how we participate in the global disconnected world. Because even during COVID-19 time, some of the work we did in Sri Lanka, we were able to continue because we were in a connected world. I mean, similarly, every industry can find that connection. And so we can be a country on our own, but we have to understand the global dynamics and how to be connected. We can't get away from that. That's a new reality. So if you learn, I think also if you provide policy support to do that, I think I'm sure Sri Lanka will see a tremendous, I think, growth. And I think Sri Lanka will, I think, truly will be able to come out, I think, as a winning country.
Now for a bit of a sensitive question, which is follow-on to the earlier one. We've been slated as to be in a debt trap, specifically to China,
yeah,
who is supposedly doing this to many developing nations.
Yeah.
taking on from what you said earlier, what kind of time period do you see us in before we can actually stand on our own?
Well, I think I'll go back to the success story of Singapore.
Right.
Singapore is just a flat land with no resources when the economy took over in 1965. Okay, I mean, part of the good part of the story is like it was right time, right place kind of thing. But he and his team were able to put something together and execute that, you know, very well to get to where they are today. So from even less than third world country, they are a first world country. That happened in 30 to 35 years time, right? So at that time, even the level of resourcing, level of technology, level of all things what you need to develop a country, maybe less than what we have now. So I think it is a mindset thing for me. I think if our policymakers, businessmen and women, and everyone who can play a role in this, put together their thoughts and honestly, I think 5 to 10 years, this is doable. Because Sri Lanka is actually a very blessed country with a lot of resources. Look at our literacy at 90 plus, digital literacy is about 40 plus. All that put together, I think it's just that execution, right? I mean, I sense that current government can do, play that role, right? And also going back to that, the story on the debt part of it, right? I mean, if you know that you are in it, you also should know how to come out of it, right? So it's like in banking, we restructure things, we reschedule things, and we do different things to, you know, come out of situation. I think similarly, the government of Sri Lanka possibly could do that. By doing that, I think you will never be caught in a debt situation. I think you can be in a totally different situation, provided you put your thoughts and the minds and execution right, and you can come out of it. 5 to 10 years, doable.
Thank you for speaking to us, Mr. Birgaon.
Thank you for having me.